that was a worst-case scenario.
I hope you guys are doing great today. This video is going to be very similar to a bunch of other videos I've done because we have a unique person here with me. Danny Puckett has been driving with Lone Star Drift. He started, 14 years ago or something like that. And he's been drifting for a long time. He got into media, and the purpose of this video is to talk to someone that has made drifting their life, their passion, their job, everything. Yeah. He of course does a little bit outside and everything, but what he does, and he's gonna talk in a second, is he has gone and made media, and gone up in ranks of media, getting better, just like we talked to Tyler Katulik, and we need to talk to Cody Slack someday.
Kapper, not Katulik.
Oh, God dang it. Anyways, Kapper, anyways. Hi, Kapper. These guys, like, Kapper shoots with Larry Chen right now, one of the best like automotive photographers in the world, or the best. He was working for a bunch of companies doing stuff. He's traveling all around the world doing amazing stuff. You've done something similar. He's been working for Vaughn Gitten Jr. and other companies, which has afforded him so many crazy experiences. And now he gets to drive with sponsorship for this event, which is Drift Week 2. Like, that is his profession now. And of course you do media outside and everything, but I want you to talk about this. Sure. Tell me about your journey, about how you made it financially possible to live your passion and to make racing a career. I mean, not exactly a career in the fact that you race,
sure,
but in the fact that you get to do what you love, be around it all the time. You don't wear a suit and tie to work. Yep. You don't work at a restaurant. You know, you don't have a normal 9-to-5. So talk.
Yeah. So, drifting and video. So, like, I guess I'm trying to think of where to start. So, really, skateboarding, actually, which is what got me into video. So as a youngin, a bunch of buddies were super good at skating. We needed to film some stuff, and I was like, I'm gonna get a camera. I've always been the chubby kid, so I'm like, I ain't doing any sick tricks. Let me just film you guys doing tricks. So got a camera, and then everything from there, I was just like, man, like, video is just super satisfying to like create something, and especially when you do it with your friends. So that just kind of snowballed, and I went to, you know, to college and for a video. In West LA, and I grew up around racing. My dad raced late model stock cars in the 90s, and so like I've always been sort of a motorhead. Well, my family owned auto body shop, and so as I got older and I started to do video stuff and skateboarding a little bit less, getting like what was the new adult version of skateboarding for me, and that was drifting. And so I'd always been super interested in it, and then my wife and I, we moved to Texas. And I was like, okay, like a lifestyle to do something fun is more tangible now. And so we found out about local events, Lone Star Drift events, and buddy Bryson of mine, we started just going to events and shooting, started mm-hmm. talking to you about possibly documenting some of the events, and you were super into it and wanted to continue on. So I right away, you know, I was like, this is how I can get close to drifting. I think I met Chelsea actually at the first event I went to, got a ride along, and I was like, this is so sick, it's insane. I'm gonna go to every event and shoot everything. So with Chelsea, you know, he was had been doing the Texas Pro-Am series, and he was pretty serious about it, and I was like, all right, this is a dude to know, and he's super cool. So I was like, all right, this is like my buddy who I'm gonna film skating, but it's gonna be drifting basically. Mm-hmm. And so as I just learned more and more about, you know, like what drifting was and how to be more involved, I just kept like, you know, what did Chelsea need and what did you need? And so it was like, how can I be more and more of this puzzle? And knowing soon that I wanted to drive, it was just a matter of like, okay, when's the right time that I can get a car? I had a 240 and had a couple E36s, and you know, it's always just been kind of like putting around fun and never really got serious about it because the video side always came first. Mm-hmm. And as Chelsea went pro, you know, with BC, and I was able to, you know, Cody Slack and kind of work with them and provide video and still be close enough to it. And that's really where I started to like build my relationships with race companies and with drivers. And I think just being loyal to it and knowing that that's where I had fun. I was always able to keep moving forward and keep growing. Had a lot of like just opportunities almost fall in my lap because of that, just because I was always there and always trying to do new things. And it just kept going to the point where I was like, all right, I'm getting a car and I'm gonna start driving as much as possible and try to bring in some of these relationships and partners and mm-hmm. make it all a reality, I guess. Yeah.
So tell us real quick, before we get in, I'm just asking you financial things about how things work and everything. Tell us a story about like you shooting with Vaughn Gitten Jr. Because you get to do, or I guess you could say with Team RTR, because you're shooting Chelsea and stuff too. Where did that take you around the world? Did you go to like Germany, or did you go, you know, what type of places did you go? What type of shoots did you do? Yeah. Was it fun? Was it serious? I don't know.
It's a little bit of all those things. So yeah, like getting, when Chelsea went to RTR, you know, I was kind of able to ride those coattails. Thank you, Chelsea, for that. but you know, Chelsea and I had been boys for a while, and I was providing him with a lot of media. And when he went to RTR, he's kind of like, hey, this is my media guy. Like, you know, if he fits into this equation, then great. And Vaughn and I, both being Maryland boys, like we hit it off right away. Just vibed super well, and he gave me an awesome opportunity to join salary on the team. And right away we jumped into it. It was nuts. He had just started doing off-road stuff. So I think actually the first event I did full-time with RTR was King of the Hammers, which was insane. But also from just like a media perspective, you know, because we're essentially like, you know, running a production house. You know, that was kind of some of the first years that he was really like full-blown, like, hey, I need, you know, full-time guy. And so I was pushed right into the fire as far as like, hey, you really have a lot to handle. The experiences are just, it's insane. Like I felt like what I was doing in a year, you know, it was just like, I felt like a lifetime of adventures. Like it was constantly, we're just doing amazing things, meeting super cool people. You mentioned Germany, the Nürburgring, that's probably like my most favorite shoot and experience with the team. And I mean, there's just never a dull moment. Like every single thing is just surreal, and it happens so quick, and then it's over, and you're just kind of left in awe. But the best part is we were documenting all of it, so there's a lot of projects to look at. But I wouldn't say that it was like, you know, too serious by any means. Like Vaughn definitely takes this company serious, but he also likes to have a lot of fun. And he's pretty clear about that with everyone on the team. So it's never too stressful to the point where you're like, why am I doing this? It's hard, like we work hard, you know, to be able to play hard. Mm-hmm. But I mean, I think just like in general, being around such like high, you know, Pennzoil, just like these big brands that are supporting the stuff that he's doing, it's more mind blowing of like, wait, what? You're getting a Ford GT and you're going to do what with it? You know, like, okay, cool.
Yeah, next level stuff.
Yeah, totally. So it's hard to describe just the feeling of like, you know, without being completely fanboyed out, you know, and like just amazed because there's a lot of business aspects. So at the same time, it's like balancing like, okay, I got to, you know, I have to keep everyone in control here. I'm directing this shoot. Like, I can't just be the guy who wants to chit chat and hang out and do all this. I'm constantly telling, you know, Vaughn and Chelsea, like, yo, we got, you know, schedule, we got things to do, we got to keep going. So it's, again, that kind of that balancing act of, like, business and fun. Mm-hmm.
So you made drifting your life.
Mm-hmm.
You, it was somewhat your life.
Yeah.
As much as you want it to be your life.
Yeah.
Sometimes you got to pull back, probably.
Totally.
Being around the correct people and getting lucky a bit of the time.
Yep.
But mostly I would say, like, as a takeaway, I'm trying to have a takeaway for you guys. Sure. As an audience, because we're talking to an audience,
yeah.
Is he went all in on something that was useful and usable by other people within the community so they would drag him along. If he just wanted to be in the seat of a race car, he would have been useless to these teams. They would have had no use to him because it was a destructive thing to do, which is what we all want to do. What we want to do is be in the seat of a race car.
Yeah.
But you have to find some way to pay for it, which is either being so good in the seat of a race car that everybody wants to sponsor you or give you money for some weird thing, or being useful as media, or being useful as a mechanic or a truck driver, whatever it is. And you found probably the least painful thing, which is to hold a camera instead of a transmission over your head.
Totally.
It's still painful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And something that scales well, because you can get an infinite amount of like views in a day, but you can only lift one transmission in a day,
yep.
Or you know, however many. Mm-hmm. So it's a great way to do something that scales well and that you can be very talented at, and you can be a very talented mechanic or driver, but not just that, but I guess you could say your skills get built to the point where you can put yourself head and shoulders above other people, just like Chelsea in the driver's seat. you can become so good at media and handling situations and doing everything else that you can make a very good livable wage and become very in demand because of the skills you acquire over a long period of time, which other people are paying you to build up, which is very difficult as a driver because it's so expensive to accrue the skills to be in a driver's seat to get good enough for it to be useful to someone. So I guess one of the takeaways of this is to be useful to other people in a way that at first you are working almost for free. I think I used to pay you guys $400 a video.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was paying them $400 a video. And that's not enough money for you guys because you were traveling to an event and doing stuff. Mm-hmm. It wasn't enough for, like, too expensive for me because I was hosting events. But, you know, we made it work. I love the content. It was great for the drivers to have stuff. But, you know, like, we had to make it work kind of thing.
Yeah.
It had to be useful to everybody because we are burning cash.
Mm-hmm.
You're burning a hotel room.
Yeah.
You're burning time and effort away from your family and everything.
Yeah.
So anyways, my takeaway is be useful, and you got
totally
very useful.
Yeah, no, I definitely use that to my advantage. And it does just that. Like you said, like, there's a lot of times where you don't get to make money in drifting, you know, shooting and
mm-hmm.
stuff. And but the good thing is that same criteria for video works with everything, you know, like mm-hmm. every company, especially now, everyone can benefit from using video. So it's just it's a good choice as far as the job goes. You know, like you said, a restaurant, you can't really do a lot. Even if you own the restaurant, there's not a lot you can do that blends into drifting, you know, unless you're going to sponsor your drift program and waste all your company's money on drifting. There's not a lot of crossover. So, like, a lot of guys, like you said, they'll start shops. You know, so many FD drivers and stuff, they all have parts companies or a shop or something, and that's great. But it's like, they still need the video guy, you know, whether they own that company or not. So if you do video yourself, you also learn a lot of the marketing aspects and you build those relationships, and you don't even have to be in the videos, you know, like, you could provide just advertisement, you know, and marketing tools and videos. So there's a lot of different ways that you can up the value of your relationship with them. Yep.
Okay. So we've kind of built up the audience that wants to get into media now and talk about it and everything. We've built them up. Now let's knock them back down and kneecap
sure.
them.
Yeah.
The reality of the situation is it is incredibly difficult to get good at media.
Yeah.
It's going to take years and years. You need to work for free for a long time. Even after you get really good, you need to work basically for free most of the time, unless you get lucky, and there's always luck involved, but
sure.
you just can't go charging people for garbage content. And if you're going to go through the YouTubing method, even at the scale of Lone Star Drift, there's no money to be made in YouTubing. You have to get really big. I'm sure somebody could make it happen, but because of the way that we work, and Cy has to eat food or else he dies,
yeah.
and things like that, it's a very difficult proposition and takes a long time to get good at. And if you were to go, like, say, bag groceries at a grocery store, they have to pay you from day one or you're not going to do it. Media is not like that. You're competing for a very fun position with a lot of people and a lot of talented people that are willing to work for free, which no one will do in the real estate world or in the bagging groceries world or working at O'Reilly's world or, you know, changing oil world. Those
yeah.
people don't work for free. So you're working with a bunch of people that will buy the most expensive gear, the most expensive anything they can to compete. We know dudes that can't even, like, work a camera and go buy $50,000 camera packages.
Oh, yeah. Yep. And they think that the work's going to fall to them that way. You know,
yeah.
It's like,
and sometimes it does.
Yeah, it totally does. A lot of people
but,
pay, you know, the client comes because of the gear, you know, or because of what you said, what you did.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, a lot of it, you know, and that's sort of the photo, video, and any really kind of freelance world. It's like, you are your product just as much as what you produce.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, you have to be able to work with these people too. So there's, like, a lot of people end up with a really sour attitude, you know, after 2 years or something. They're like, oh, you know, why didn't I get my big break, or, you know, whatever. And it's like, I mean, hey, you should be doing it because you really enjoy it and you want to anyways. Otherwise, you will probably stop eventually.
Mm-hmm.
But really the consistency and just, like, always having a good attitude and being there, you know, and even though you didn't get paid on this gig, you know, hoping that on the next one you do, or, you know, you're worth paying on the next one. So there's definitely a lot of, like, yeah, it's pretty cutthroat. There's, like you said, there's not any other industry where people are just showing up and shooting for free and coming out of pocket, you know, and spending a lot of money to basically be your competitor. So you have to kind of find your hole and, you know, your spot in there. And also, you know, working with drivers, like lucky enough, you know, the stars kind of aligned, like when I met Chelsea, and he was so serious, and video was becoming, you know, sort of a thing then. So it's also timing, you know, especially even for somebody like Adam too, you know, it was like timing was just so perfect for everything for him, you know, as far as like having a great early start.
Oh yeah, timing is everything in this.
Yeah, and then his build up, you know, and going into driving, because he kind of had a similar thing, you know, like it wasn't driving first, you know, he wasn't like, oh, I'm a pro driver, I want to be a pro driver, you know, how do I dial back? He kind of reverse engineered it. Mm-hmm. So it was like he had a really great time being able to elevate himself so quickly, driving in through media and support. So there's definitely a lot of different aspects. There are a lot of different ways that you can do it. It's just kind of like finding what is yours. But media is tough. It's crazy. I mean, people ask all the time for advice, and it's like, I can tell you so many things, but there's only so many perfect things for you.
Yeah. And they might have worked 5 years ago, and they might not work today.
Yep.
The video market, I was posting on Vimeo. I always make that joke.
Yeah.
We didn't even have a YouTube account until like everybody was always already big on YouTube. And I was like, that looks like garbage on there. And I wouldn't post. I was like, I don't want my videos to look bad, you idiots.
Yeah, no one goes to YouTube.
And then that was a huge mistake.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. I'm now uploading videos that we made 10 years ago to YouTube because of the same thing. They were on Vimeo. And I was like, I'm going to watch this Vimeo.
No, but Vimeo still looks better to this
day. It does. It's very crisp and it's very clean. But
okay. Well, I think we covered about everything. I think that I have personally seen, even just from the Lone Star Drift guys, Tyler Kapper, Danny Puckett, Cody Slack. Was there anybody else that went professional out of our media people?
You got Max.
Oh, yeah, Max.
Yeah.
Max first. Mm-hmm. We have at least 4 guys that are professional video guys, and it's a higher hit ratio than our drivers that went professional and lasted forever, which would be Chelsea Denofa, and that's about it, who's one of the top 6 guys in Formula D, if you ask Chelsea, the top one. It's a way easier thing to do than to become the best driver in the world.
Totally.
And you don't have to inhale so much smoke, which is arguable. You probably inhale a lot of smoke.
Yeah, it depends on the layout or the track, but yeah.
And you're useful, and people come to you, and you don't have to hustle quite as hard as a driver. Chelsea is the hardest hustling person on earth, and it is so hard to get to that point. And almost the door is closed on that. It would be so hard to do what Chelsea did now, whereas for media, it's almost easier now. An iPhone, before, back when you started, you had to have a camera that cost at least $1,000 and a couple $1,000 in lenses and everything else. Now you can just use your phone and murder it.
Oh yeah.
I mean, like, there's almost, the more you spend on gear now limits you and makes it harder to deal with stuff.
Yeah.
I just film on my phone half the time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Airdrop it to an editing machine.
Oh, it's insane. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, any closing statements?
No, I don't think so.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for watching. I hope you guys found this interview. A lot of YouTube is just like clickbait stuff or whatever. I really do want to help people out and to see people succeed. And for myself, the more people that succeed from... Oh, by the way, he hosts an event series in San Antonio called Club Loose, and is part of those guys. So that's Club Loose Texas. Go check them out. But I want people within the Texas Drift community or Lone Star Drift or Club Loose or whatever these communities are, I want them to have a chance to make drifting some, like, their passion, to live it, everything else. Because I see so many people make it their entire lives, but maybe get a little bit lost in it and don't think things through long term. And I'm not saying everybody should be a media guy or a professional driver or a mechanic. It is way easier to become a doctor than most of these things.
Yeah.
It would be way easier to become a doctor than a professional driver. I am not joking. 100% it would be easier to be a doctor and take less time.
Yeah.
So
you'd still be able to go drifting.
And waste less money.
Yeah. And it would be cheaper. It would be cheaper to be a doctor than to be that. So anyways, think about your life. Think about how to make these things your passion. I don't want to push somebody into that. I just want to educate people. And because I've been around drifting now for 20 years, I want to make sure people have a fair shake at it and go into it with, because there's still, you know, like, with a full arsenal of information, because there's still so many people that think they're just going to jump in a car and be a professional driver. And you sit them down and you tell them what it takes and stuff. And they're just like, oh, I'll just try. And you're like, there's no trying. It's just like being a doctor. Like, you have to hit all these steps. And if you don't hit those steps, you can't do it.
Yep.
And they're like, whatever. And I'm like, whatever. Bye.
Yep.
Okay. That's it. See you later. Boom. Oh, wait. Don't stop recording. I want to say special thanks to the sponsors of this event, BC Racing Coilovers, Y-Plate Imports, and also ECU Master USA. Please go to all of their social media pages on Instagram and wherever. Just go to Instagram and just message them and be like, hey, thank you so much for supporting Drift Week 2. We'd really appreciate that. I'm sure they'd even appreciate it more if you bought something, but even just give them a shout out. Say like, thank you so much. We appreciated the content. I really appreciate it. It's not just the content they support, it's the whole event. We couldn't do this event without their support. So thank you so much, sponsors. BC Racing, Y Play Imports, ECU Master USA. Now I'm done.